I just want to welcome everyone here today. This is a terrific program put together by the Dwight Opperman Institute for Judicial Administration. I want to thank my colleagues who run the Institute, Sam Estreicher, who's up here, Oscar Chase, and I very much want to thank Troy McKenzie, my colleague who is the impresario of this morning, sitting in the middle and going to make sure that we have a great conversation throughout the morning for this program on the Roberts Court. This is really a family event. Evan, why are you sitting there? So this is a family event. If you look up on the panel, a number of people in our faculty, Rachel Barkow, Sam Estreicher, Troy McKenzie, Rick Pildes, and you know they're on our faculty. You probably don't know that Paul Clement, also on our faculty, just taught a terrific seminar last semester with Rick Pildes on the Supreme Court. And for some reason, we have a panelist sitting over there, Evan Chesler, who is also on our faculty teaching a great trial practice course this semester. I'm sorry, you know, I guess it probably follows that Peter Buscemi and Bob Long will soon be teaching here. And I was just, the only reason I came, I'm standing in the way of the intellectual excitement, but I came here for recruitment purposes. And to you know let you all know that we have a great faculty up here to guide you through what I know will be a great morning on the Roberts Court. So I will turn over the mic to Troy.
I don't need it.
The impresario.
Yes, I can. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome. So the reason for having this discussion is that even though John Roberts has been Chief Justice for not quite 5 years yet, perhaps it's time to step back a little bit, take stock, and think about what the court has become under his leadership and where the court might be going in the next several years under John Roberts. And perhaps you might think it's too early to do that, but of course if you look at the first 5 years of the court under Chief Justice Earl Warren, or the first 5 years of the court under Chief Justice Warren Burger, or Chief Justice Rehnquist, there were early decisions in those courts that really set the tone for the rest of those chief justiceships. I want to say just a few words about the folks we have up here on the panel. And I want to start with my colleague, Rachel Barkow, who teaches criminal law and administrative law here at NYU, has extensive publications in those areas, including recent scholarship on the Supreme Court's continuing extensive involvement in death penalty cases. Rachel joined the faculty after several years in private practice in Washington, D.C., and before that she was a law clerk to Justice Antonin Scalia. Peter Buscemi, who is right here on my left, heads the appellate litigation practice at Morgan Lewis, his office in Washington, D.C. He was an assistant to the Solicitor General from 1977 to 1981 and has argued 15 cases in the Supreme Court and participated in the briefing of many, many others. Paul Clement. Paul was the 43rd Solicitor General of the United States from 2005 to 2008. Before that, he was acting Solicitor General, and before that, the Principal Deputy in the Solicitor General's office. He is now a partner at King & Spalding in their Washington office, where he heads their appellate litigation group. He was also a law clerk to Justice Antonin Scalia, and he has argued, by my count, over 50 cases in the Supreme Court, including landmark cases such as the McCain-Feingold case, McConnell against FEC, one of the most important sentencing cases, United States against Booker, the late McConnell against FEC, I should say, and several of the war on terrorism cases, including Rumsfeld against Padilla. My colleague, Sam Estreicher, who needs no introduction, I think, to this audience, teaches, among other things, labor and employment law here at NYU and is the co-director of the IJA. Sam was a law clerk to Justice Lewis Powell before joining the faculty at NYU in 1978. He's also a frequent commentator on the court. He's participated in many, many cases at the appellate level and before the Supreme Court, and is of counsel at Jones Day, where he participates with their appellate litigation group. Bob Long is a partner at Covington and Burling, where he chairs the appellate and Supreme Court litigation group, and has argued 14 cases in the Supreme Court. Bob was a law clerk to Chief Justice Lewis Powell, and was assistant to the Solicitor General from 1990 to 1993, where he served with an obscure young lawyer by the name of John Roberts. Bob serves as an adjunct at Georgetown and also at UVA Law School, and is someone who has incredible knowledge about many areas of the law, and also has pretty good trivia about many cases that have come before the Supreme Court, as I've learned over time. And finally, Rick Pildes, my colleague. Rick is one of the most important scholars of legal questions touching on democracy and the political process. He is a leading figure on the Voting Rights Act, on election law, and constitutional law more broadly. And in fact, his writings in this area have been cited by the Supreme Court. In fact, in the recent Voting Rights Act case, I believe both the majority and the separate opinion cited his work. He's also involved in ongoing litigation about the constitutionality of the Sarbanes-Oxley statute, and was a law clerk before entering academia to Justice Thurgood Marshall. So with those introductions out of the way, I would like to turn to my colleague Rachel Barkow to start us in our discussion on the court's criminal law and criminal procedure docket.
Do I need one of these? Okay. So I guess the cases that I would point us to first that I think might have the most dramatic significance this term would be the court's review of the Honest Services statute, which this is the statute that's used to prosecute public corruption at the local and state, and it could be at federal level too, but it's chiefly used by federal prosecutors to prosecute public corruption cases and also corruption by high-level executives and corporations as well. And it's been criticized by Justice Scalia over the past few years, and the court finally took cert on a trio of cases involving this issue. And they've already heard argument in a couple of them. There's one to go involving Jeff Skilling. And the reason I think I'm starting with these is because I think the court is poised to strike down this statute as unconstitutionally vague. And that'd be quite significant for the federal government's efforts to use this statute to get at various kinds of fraud. Sam, I know, has been involved in one of these cases, and so he might have something to say about it in greater detail. But I think it does show you one that this court is willing to strike down criminal statutes, at least when the targets are when it's a vague statute and it's targeting high-level officials. There's obviously some federalism concerns with using this statute as a matter of public corruption against local and state actors. I'll go through the greatest hits of things I think to look for. Is this one not working? Okay, is this better? Sorry. Okay, so hopefully you caught some of that. Honest services, I think, going down. That's basically, that's the summary there. The other thing I would look for is the court decided a case called Herring, and in that case, you know, many academics are predicting that might be the beginning of the end of the exclusionary rule. I think it's too soon to say, but I think this might fall into Troy's category of cases that you'll look back on it later and say, that's where the beginning of the end for the Fourth Amendment's exclusionary rule was. It's possible. It's possible that's a turn the court is taking, because the court seems willing to accept that a negligent mistake by a police officer, you know, this would be taking the holding further than it is, but it's setting the groundwork for any negligent mistake by a police officer not leading to the bar on the use of evidence. This case just involved a record-keeping mistake, and so it's by the police department, and so it's possible it won't sweep so broadly, but again, this is the kind of case to keep an eye on because I could see the jurisprudence going further. sentencing is sort of the thing that is near and dear to my heart, and the court in recent years, for anyone who works with the federal sentencing guidelines, you know, it's been exciting times, because the Supreme Court has made that into what used to be mandatory guidelines are advisory now. And I think that's water under the bridge, and that's not going to be changing, but the court's going to be deciding, you know, continually looking at issues related to that line of cases and how far that goes. And there, the person to watch is just really, it's going to be Justice Sotomayor, because Justice Souter was necessary for all of those decisions, and I think it just remains to be seen where she comes out on those issues. Death penalty, Troy had mentioned at the outset, the court continues to engage in lots and lots of oversight of the capital punishment process in the United States. So it keeps taking cases, even if it's really factual issues as to just whether or not there's factual support for the decision. I don't see them getting out of that business anytime soon,
so
either.
Rachel, if
yeah.
I could interrupt you,
yes.
Why not? I mean, if you had told me 5 years ago that a new Chief Justice, new members of the court will mean that the Supreme Court is going to continue taking a fair number of death penalty cases, doing very extensive review of the record, almost sort of error correction in a way that the court doesn't do in any other area, I would have laughed at you. I would have said the court's going to get out of that business because the new justices coming onto the court won't think that it's worth the court's time, either for ideological reasons or just for a view of what the court should do as an institution. So why the continued interest?
Well, I wouldn't have expected you to make that prediction if the appointees were from a Democratic president, because I think that would be the list of appointees least likely to take the stance. Oh, we're out of the capital punishment business, you know. I don't think that's likely to happen. I think anyone who pays close attention to capital punishment is concern that at a minimum that the process be an equitable one and have some oversight. Now, whether that requires fact-bound review by the Supreme Court is definitely a debatable question, but I think given that that seems to be the last stop for every execution in the United States makes a run on the Supreme Court at the end, the court sees them all. And I think overseeing that process and knowing the Innocence Project work, knowing that this is an issue that the public pays close attention to, I don't see them getting out of this business soon unless you get a lot more justices who take a view of the court's role is more limited such that it would override what might be concerns with capital punishment generally. And I guess my thought here is just that I have a hard time seeing a President Obama appointee being the ones to kind of step in and say, what are you guys doing? Because I just think that on this issue, they're likely to share a more consensus liberal sentiment that there's a role for the Supreme Court here. That's
but,
a prediction. Not
but,
a,
the, you know, the court is taking cases that aren't just death sentence individuals seeking cert. They're also taking cases where the state, say, coming out of, I don't know, the Ninth Circuit, for example, you know, the state of California or the state of Nevada, is going up to the Supreme Court to challenge a decision that finds the death penalty in a particular case to be inapplicable or unconstitutional or whatever. And the court will take those cases, which are often just error correction as well. So
it's usually a sufficient reason for the case to come from the Ninth Circuit.
Sam's kind of onto something there. I think the reason there, so you know, you just need four justices to want to take the case, obviously. And I think you do have a block of four that's worried that there are courts of appeals out there who are impeding the use of the death penalty. You know, it's a very divided court on the question of capital punishment. And I think you have a sufficient number on both sides that they take an interest from both sides. I think there are justices on the court that say, this is the law, and just judges, the lower court judges are supposed to be upholding that law. And if they see a decision below that looks like judges are letting personal views about capital punishment override what they believe the law to be required, I think you'll get four justices to say, we have to take cert in this case. There's an error in the application of federal law.
Can I ask you a question about the mail fraud cases? You said that the court was going to strike them down as unconstitutionally vague.
Don't
even
bet
though
money
the underlying conduct in most of these cases arguably clearly culpable.
Not arguably, it's culpable.
Culpable.
It's
now, this is a theme that I'd like folks to think about. This court is very often grabbing for the broadest possible ground rather than narrowest ground. So if your prediction is right, this would be an example of it. But I think there are also non-constitutional grounds that are argued in all of these cases that could lead to overturning the convictions as well. So is the court being as narrow as it could be or as broad as it can be? And recall Chief Justice Roberts' testimony that he was just a little old judge who was going to decide cases as he sees them. And so this is a theme I'd like us to think about.
I don't think that was the phrase he used, Sam.
Yeah.
My paraphrase.
Yeah. Umpire.
We're supposed to wait to talk about Citizens United until later, so I feel like that we could address that in the context of maybe, that seems like maybe a more obvious example of that. I do think that there are cases this term that'll help me answer that question for you, though, because I'm curious to see what they do with honest services. The other case I'll just mention briefly is the Humanitarian Law Project case, is a case involving whether or not the material support statute, which is used to prosecute terrorists, people who give material support to designated terrorist organizations, whether that is also unconstitutionally vague. And I think seeing how the court comes out in those cases will give us a lot of insight as to where the court might be going. I mean, if you picked up the criminal code, there's a lot of vague stuff in there. And so for the court to say these statutes, these are the bad ones, it's hard in a lot of ways to distinguish those from the bread and butter of a lot of other statutes. I mean, mail fraud, wire fraud, there's a lot of things in there that aren't so clear. So I'm looking to those to see what they will do. But I think in the criminal area, this has been an aggressive court in a lot of areas, and some of them have been pro-defendant, I should point out. It's not taken the narrow road on sentencing, and it hasn't taken the narrow road on confrontation clause. They are charging ahead. So, and those are defendant protective decisions by a group of five of the justices and sometimes more, depending on the case. So I don't think they've been minimalist in this area, and sometimes they've been protective of defendants, and sometimes they have in other contexts that we'll talk about. In the criminal area, though, there have been a lot of robust pro-defendant decisions by an interesting block on the court that typically includes some of the liberal justices plus Justice Scalia and sometimes Justice Thomas coming together. It's a kind of a combination of originalism, commitment to textualism and clear statutes, together with a liberal block of justices that have really revolutionized a lot of areas of criminal law. And I think it'll be interesting to see whether that continues, because it really does depend on Justice Sotomayor, and I think any replacements coming up this summer, because I'm not so convinced that the new justices that join the court will share those commitments.
Even if they're appointed by a Democrat.
Correct.
Can I just follow up on that, Troy, and say, you know, I really think that Rachel is exactly right about that, and one theme that, well, no, I want to elaborate. But it's a comma and, not a comma but. And what I want to elaborate on is the idea that I think a theme that may emerge from our discussion at some point is at least a question that has to arise is, you know, is this the Roberts Court or is this really the Kennedy Court? And I think that is pretty demonstrably not true, that it's not the Kennedy Court when it comes to criminal decisions outside the capital context. I think in the capital context, Justice Kennedy does hold kind of the key vote, as he does in so many areas. But if you look at the court's criminal docket, I mean, you know, for better or for worse, it's almost been that Justice Scalia is a criminal defendant's best friend on this court. He has been, as Rachel said, kind of the motivating force behind the court taking a second look at the honest services fraud issue. But he's also been kind of, you know, one of the leading voice on the Confrontation Clause and one of the leading voices, along with Justice Stevens, on the sentencing issues. And even in the Fourth Amendment context, where he's part of the block of the court that is, you know, maybe taking a very dim view of the exclusionary rule, he was also the fifth vote in the Gantt case last year to limit the police's ability to provide a search of the entire vehicle. And what's really striking is that if you tally up at the end of the term the number of Justice Kennedy dissents, it's almost always a really low number. But they tend to be in these criminal cases. He tends to be in dissent in all the sentencing cases. He tends to be in dissent, not in everyone, but in most of the Confrontation Clause cases. He's been, I think he was in the dissent in the Gantt case, this Fourth Amendment vehicular search case. So it's the one area where I think you can really say that, you know, just Chief Justice Roberts tends to be in the dissent in some of these cases too. So in this one area, it's not the Kennedy Court. It may be kind of the Scalia Court if he can hold Justice Sotomayor.
Because the party line doesn't work in those cases.
No, it really doesn't work in these cases.
There's another case in which Justice Scalia joined Breyer and Souter and Ginsburg and formed the five members because the trial judge did not want to admit pro hoc vice, the defendant's chosen counsel. So you had the four liberal justices and Justice Scalia saying, no, You can't rely on some state rule about pro hoc vice admission to deprive the defendant of his choice of counsel. And Chief Justice Roberts and Alito and Kennedy were all in dissent in that case. So that's another illustration.
Any final words, Rachel?
The only thing I'll say about that, because I do think it's just an interesting thing to think about if we get another Republican president who has nominees to the court, is it does show you that, you know, originalism gets a very bad rap in the public view because there's people focus on very high profile matters where it leads to conservative results. But it's not coincidence, I think, that Justice Scalia is where he is on these issues, because he really does take an originalist position that leads him to this result and he follows it. And in that sense, it's interesting to just think about whether if your goal was to have liberal outcomes on the court, to maximize those, and you know you have a Republican president, do you prefer the originalist justice, or do you prefer the justice that comes in more along the lines of Chief Justice Roberts and Justice Alito, who they don't really talk about methodology that way? And I have to say, when you follow criminal justice, there's a lot to be said for the justice who stakes out the principled position at the outset and holds to it. Because if the only thing you are is a more conservative jurist without an overarching methodology, I do think you're more likely to reach conservative results across the board than if you have a methodology that sometimes you apply it and it leads to a liberal result. And I think there is a criminal justice. Now, obviously, this is the area I follow most intently, and that may not be the case of this audience, but it does show you, I think, just a larger theme in terms of judicial appointments, that it's not so clear that if you have the conservative that's just conservative in a kind of pragmatic way, that on net gets you more liberal results overall. I think people think of that with Justice O'Connor.
Non-pragmatic conservatives.
I didn't say that, but I do think that the pragmatic approach has been associated with Justice O'Connor for so long that it's taken on this light that, oh, that must mean reasonable moderation. And I don't think that that's necessarily the result of that. And I would just use the criminal cases as an area to look at and see that may not be the case.
So just one final question in this area. The Confrontation Clause cases, these were cases that started building under the Rehnquist Court. There have been a series of these cases through the Roberts Court, very pro-defendant cases, reviving what seemed to have been a dead letter in the Bill of Rights, finding that defendants had the right to be confronted with a witness before them, can't use hearsay evidence, et cetera, very pro-defendant decisions. And then Justice Souter, who was part of the block that was finding in favor of defendants in these cases, leaves the court. Justice Sotomayor comes onto the court, former assistant district attorney, and the view is the Confrontation Clause cases are all going to get reversed. And the court grants cert in a case that is, at least as far as I could tell, indistinguishable from a Confrontation Clause case the court had just decided last term. They hear argument on it, and they
per curiam, vacate and remand to decide it in light of the case from the prior term, which I think shows that they're going to respect that precedent.
Why?
You know, I doubt that we'll see more expansion of the Confrontation Clause, but I think that it looks like Justice Sotomayor is not going to come in there and start overruling precedent, at least in that area.
Okay. I'd like to turn to Bob Long to lead off our discussion on the court's business and commercial law docket.
Good morning, and I'd like to start by thanking Troy for putting the business cases second before we get to the First Amendment and voting rights. I think there's at least a chance that people will find this interesting this early in the morning. Well, you know, the sort of overall picture that you will see in the New York Times and elsewhere is that the Roberts Court is taking more business cases than the Rehnquist Court. And that in general, we're getting more decisions that tend to favor business as against consumers and sometimes government. And a sort of common explanation for that is that Chief Justice Roberts was a Supreme Court lawyer in Washington before he became a judge, and he often represented business interests. He understands where they're coming from. If you view this trend with alarm, you could say he's been captured by business interests. So I think that's probably a summary of the common wisdom, at least according to the New York Times. And I think there's some truth to that, a lot of truth to that actually, but I'd suggest a few qualifications. You know, of course, this will be a theme, I think, that emerges through a lot of our discussion. You know, Chief Justice Roberts is only one of nine. You know, I think we're still finding out whether it's really going to be the Roberts Court. And, you know, each time there's a new justice, there's really a new court to some extent. We've got one new one this term. You know, we'll probably have some new ones soon, as soon as next term. So, you know, just because Chief Justice Roberts has this background doesn't mean the whole court is necessarily going to see it that way. You know, another qualification is, and this really picks up on the criminal cases, it's not a strictly conservative liberal divide in the business cases. Often the, you know, the sort of the liberal justices will vote in favor of the business side of a case. And a lot of times these are not 5-4 cases or even 6-3 cases. There can be, you know, 9-0 or close to unanimity. And justices like Justice Breyer and Justice Ginsburg will frequently agree with the business side of the case. And similarly, the conservatives don't always line up on the side of business. You know, again, as in the criminal situation, you see that preemption is an example of that. I'll just talk about that for a minute, or we may get into it in discussion in a minute. You know, conservative justices that have a strong commitment to the powers of the states and are reluctant to find that federal law displaces state law are often not sympathetic to arguments that corporations make that the federal law ought to preempt the state law. So in general, you know, these cases, I would say, at least so far, are often just not as ideologically charged as some of the other cases that the court has, especially the ones that we tend to spend the most time talking about and thinking about. You know, and I would say that at least now there is something like a consensus that the business cases are important, that they're important to our economy, they're important to our society, and you know, so the justices are tackling difficult issues, technically difficult issues for lawyers and judges, you know, often in a mood that's not with a lot of ideological charge, a highly charged ideological environment. And I just raise as a question, you know, is that something that's going to change? We're coming through the Great Recession. You know, there seems to be some upwelling of populism. I mean, we don't have anything like Justice Douglas, or, you know, there used to be this sort of populist strain on the court that was really, I think you could say, sort of anti-business, or at least in favor of lots and lots of regulation of business. You know, we'll just have to see. That could change. It could change with appointments to the court. It could change with the court, I would say, in a, you know, less dramatic way, just sort of responding to changes in the country. So I'll mention a couple of areas. There are a lot of areas we could talk about, you know, antitrust, patents, securities law, employment law. We can get into those. But let me just mention quickly the so-called pleading revolution and preemption. Just take a minute on those two and then have discussion. You know, the pleading revolution, and this is the Iqbal case and the Twombly case, for those of you who are keeping score. You know, the so-called pleading revolution is important to business. I mean, not just to business, but this is all about when you get past a motion to dismiss in a civil case. And that's important, of course, because that means you get into discovery. That greatly increases the cost of the litigation. It increases the settlement value of the litigation. So it has a big impact on you know, how civil litigation goes. And there was the Twombly antitrust case several years ago where the court said, you know, we had this old Conley against Gibson case, which says you get past the motion to dismiss unless there's no set of facts on which a plaintiff would be entitled to relief. And in Twombly, in an antitrust setting, where the issue was, well, gee, you know, competitors often just engage in the same behavior because that's just, they have the same goals and they're looking at the same situation. So it's really not that plausible to infer just from parallel behavior by competitors that they had made an agreement in restraint of trade. So in Twombly, the court said, you know, we're now going to look to see whether, you know, taking the the facts that are alleged and are accepted as true, do they state a legal claim that's plausible on its face? Not probable, but more than possible. And there was
Bob, can I ask you a question? What does that mean?
Well, that's a good question, Troy. And, you know, and the court said in this Iqbal case, where they came back and said, we really meant it, it's all civil cases, it's not just antitrust cases, they said, you know, well, this is context specific. Courts are going to have to draw on their judicial experience.
I'm not hearing a definition.
So this is not, you know, now Justice, we've got a lot of Justice Scalia clerks up here, so we have people come, you know, certain justices, you know, really don't like these rules that give judges lots of discretion. And I guess it's not my brief today to complain about Iqbal and Twombly. The business community likes it. But it's not the brightest line that Justice Scalia has ever signed on to.
I teach civil procedure, and I'm, you know, I participate on civil procedure listservs and so forth. And the biggest sport is figuring out, well, how crazy was the court in Iqbal and Twombly? And people come up with more and more hyperbolic ways of describing how wrong the court was in those cases. Because for civil proceduralists, the court seemed to have taken what had been a fairly well-settled doctrine, entrenched over 50, almost 60 years, reaffirmed multiple times, was relatively clear, had some play in the joints, and chucked it over the side. Why?
Well, I mean, you know, you've got different perspectives up here. I'm a practitioner. I'm just, you know, in the trenches writing briefs on a day-to-day basis. And I used Conley v. Gibson. Sometimes businesses are plaintiffs, and, you know, I filed a brief in the Twombly case, and I will tell you honestly, I was surprised when the opinion came out and they said Conley v. Gibson is overboard. I think the court was persuaded by this general argument that if you can simply, you know, allege some facts that, however improbable, you know, could conceivably get you to liability, then you get into discovery. They were persuaded by some pretty persuasive submissions, I would say, that really makes civil litigation very expensive, very wasteful. And leads to situations where people are paying a lot to settle cases that have no merit.
So here's what I don't understand about these cases. On the one hand, one of the arguments that the dissenters in Twombly and Iqbal seem to rely on is, if you're worried about the cost of litigation, then you have to trust district judges who are on the ground in the trenches, who have tremendous tools at their disposal to limit discovery, to stop discovery, to otherwise ride herd on the lawyers and cut back on the scope of litigation. You have to trust judges. The majority in both of those cases says, we don't trust judges to do that. But we do trust judges to exercise their discretion to figure out when a case is plausible and not plausible. How can you trust judges in one context but not trust them in another context in the same area of law?
Well, you know, I'm not, I don't think I have a convincing answer to that question. And I would also say, some of you may have seen the recent studies that have been done of how, in other contexts, you know, judges will reach different decisions where they get these kinds of discretionary standards. So I think just as, you know, some judges before Twombly and Iqbal were probably being tougher on discovery and others less tough, depending on their, you know, general sense of, well, there might be something here, let's pursue it. I think under Twombly and Iqbal, you're going to see a range of responses from judges on whether they think things get passed.
Bob, is there a rulemaking fix here? Is there an easy fix?
If it doesn't work well,
just make clear in the rule?
I would think there would be.
Let me say a couple of things about these cases. Number one, I'm not at all sure what's going to happen under these two decisions in the run-of-the-mill civil case. I think these cases, although they don't acknowledge it, are driven largely by the facts of the cases. You had the Twombly case where there was no suggestion by the plaintiffs whatsoever of why they thought the parallel behavior by competitors had been undertaken pursuant to an illegal agreement rather than simply by the competitors acting in their own self-interest. And the proposition that they were acting in their own self-interest was very strong on the facts of that case. In the Iqbal case, of course, you had a lawsuit against the Attorney General of the United States and several subordinate federal officials, including the director of the Federal Bureau of Investigation.
In their personal capacity.
And their personal capacity. Yeah. And the court was just not inclined to allow a case saying that they had made a conscious decision discriminating on the basis of ethnicity to round up every Arab American in the New York metropolitan area and put them in jail for a while, which was essentially the allegation of the complaint. So I think how this rule or change plays out in the run-of-the-mill civil cases is yet to be seen. Secondly, I think that there was, even before Twombly and Iqbal, there was some play in the joints, as Bob said, in trial courts dealing with very scant complaints or complaints that were implausible on their face. I had one federal district judge ask me one time, if the plaintiff alleges that he's Napoleon, don't I have to take that as true on a motion to dismiss? And I think the answer to that question is no, you don't have to take it as true on a motion to dismiss. But there were some people who, you know, took it further than others, even before these decisions. And finally, on the discovery point, that one I have a strong response to. The difference between discovery and legal rulings on motions to dismiss is that district courts are prepared to make legal rulings on motions to dismiss because it's a one-time deal, but they are not prepared to supervise discovery. They simply say, your discovery period is the next 9 months, go and have fun, I'll see you then. And so the likelihood in the run-of-the-mill case that a district judge is really going to grab the reins and supervise discovery and make sure that improper discovery doesn't go on is pretty small. I mean, if good district judges still do it, but they are the exception, not the rule.
I will say one thing in support of what Peter just said. Think about the decisions below in Twombly and Iqbal. In both cases, you have a district judge bouncing a case on a 12b6 motion. The Court of Appeals revives the case, and then the Supreme Court is actually agreeing with what the judge on the ground is doing. So that tends to support your view against my hyperbolic musings earlier.
Let me mention then preemption, which is, I think, another interesting area that, you know, probably doesn't get all the attention that it deserves. It's important. Business, of course, often likes preemption because it allows them to just be regulated by federal law and not by the laws of 50 states and a lot of municipalities. I think there are some fault lines and some, you know, areas of tension at the Supreme Court now, not so much with the express preemption where, you know, Congress says the law is preempted, although there are some arguments about that around the edges, but in the area of implied preemption and especially, you know, what we call obstacle preemption or Hines against Davidowitz preemption, where it's not, federal law hasn't occupied the field, it's not physically impossible to comply with the federal and state law, you could do both, but the argument is it's an obstacle, a substantial obstacle to achieving the purposes and goals of the federal statute or the federal law to comply with the state law. And that's where there's been debate. You know, obviously this gets back to our theme of play in the joints, you know, and how do you know whether the obstacle is substantial enough? There's, you know, room to disagree about that frequently. Another area where there's been disagreement is what about federal agencies? You know, not so much when they preempt state law by a notice and comment rule that they clearly are authorized to promulgate. I mean, there's been a number of Supreme Court cases saying that's okay. But what about when they say, well, we think as the expert agency that administers the federal statute that this state law is really an obstacle and so it's preempted in our view. What weight, if any, does that get? In the Wyeth against Levine case, and also the Regal against Medtronic case, which I'll just mention briefly, I think are maybe the best single window into where the court is right now and where it might be going. These cases, you may know, were about preemption of state law claims for failure to warn about the dangers of prescription drugs or medical devices. So both approved by the Food and Drug Administration with a lot of regulation of the warnings that have to go with these products. And so the preemption argument, and I should disclose that I was the lawyer for Pharma, the big trade association, and Wyeth against Levine. So you can't regard me as any kind of a neutral or detached commentator here. But with that disclaimer, basically, the court first decided the Regal against Medtronic case. And the argument in both cases was largely, the FDA has really looked at this. They've arrived at a kind of balance of what's the right level of warnings. And just as there's a problem with underwarning, there's also a problem with overwarning. Because if you have too many warnings, people may not use a product that actually would help them on balance. And also, you can just make the warnings sort of noise. If there are too many warnings, people won't know what to pay attention to. They'll recognize that some of them are kind of silly, and so they may not, pay enough attention to the warnings that really matter. So in Regal against Medtronic, the court agreed that there was preemption. That set up the Wyeth against Levine case. Regal was the medical devices. Wyeth against Levine was the prescription drugs. So bigger stakes. And there, the court came out the other way and said no preemption, except maybe in a few unusual cases. Why the difference? Well, one sort of surface explanation, not just the surface explanation, is for medical devices, there's an express preemption clause. So that's not this implied kind of preemption. Another difference, I would say, is this would have been a pretty big change. I mean, this was, this would have affected a pretty big area of litigation. The court actually said in its opinion, we really don't see evidence that Congress intended to do this. So we're reluctant to do it. The FDA, this gets into the theme of what's the role of the agency. The FDA had said they thought there was preemption, but they had not done it by notice and comment rulemaking. They'd just done it in a preamble to a rule. They had changed their position that they had taken in the past. And the court said, in that kind of situation, we give only the Skidmore deference, which is, as somebody says, our briefs get Skidmore deference. That you read it, and if it's persuasive, I'll be persuaded. If it's not, it's not very much. I mean, and the last thing I'll mention about that, it really wasn't that close a decision. It was 6-3, I think. And again, I mean, Justice Thomas actually was against preemption. And he said he just thinks this whole idea of obstacle preemption is wrong, and he's not going to agree to it in any case. So that's another part of the theme of this is not strictly a conservative liberal lineup.
You already brought up the financial crisis and the Supreme Court's inevitable role in sort of responding to various initiatives of government, whether it's new statutes or regulations. And this is obviously, over the next decade, going to be one of the most significant things the court confronts. And one point I wanted to make about all that is that I'm extremely concerned that the court simply doesn't understand the institutions and the system and the structure of financial regulation that we have. And I don't blame them. Because it is so unbelievably fragmented, chaotic, full of redundant agencies, relying on private actors to interact with public institutions in various ways. And as somebody who's taught administrative and constitutional law for over 20 years now, when I was forced to begin to sink my teeth into the system of financial regulation and trying to understand it because of some cases I've been involved in recently, I was really stunned by how much a world onto its own it is, and how different the system of financial regulation looks compared to most of the regulatory systems that I had been familiar with. And that the complexity and the failure of the court to understand, I think, the complexity contributes to some decisions that I think have actually contributed to the financial crisis that have not gotten very much public attention yet. And I'll explain the specific context in a moment, but the confusion here, I think, in the court is not something that is, you know, particularly ideological. It doesn't fall out along the conventional liberal conservative lines. The decisions that I'm thinking of that I'll mention in a moment are not obviously coming from a deregulatory philosophical perspective on the court, but nonetheless they've had profound consequences for the development of the financial crisis. So in particular, before the debacle began, the state attorney generals were very active in using the tools they had to prosecute consumer fraud in areas like the origination of mortgages, some of these problems with Alt-A and subprime mortgages and some of the credit card issues. The attorney generals in a number of states were onto some of what was going on before this blossomed into the complete collapse of the housing market and then the financial sector. But there are federal agencies that also oversee, obviously, the banking system, and there are many of these agencies with very weirdly parceled out authority. There's the Office of the Comptroller of Currency, there's the Office of Thrift Supervision, there's the Federal Reserve Board, there's the Federal Trade Commission, which regulates consumer practices, or practices that affect consumers. And the court had to confront the question of whether a regulation by one of these actors, the OCC, validly preempted all of this state attorney general investigation and prosecution of financial institutions that were engaging in what the states thought to be commercial fraud in areas like the mortgage market. And the federal agency took the position that its regulations took the states out of this area completely, and the Supreme Court agreed with that. And so all of that litigation that was beginning to expose these problems came to a screeching halt as a result of a preemption decision by a federal regulatory agency and the court upholding that decision.
Bob, do you have a view about that?
Are you talking about Waters
yes.
v. Wachovia
yes.
Bank? I don't know whether Rick knows this. I was Wachovia's lawyer and argued and won the Wachovia case, so won't be surprised.
So you too contributed to the financial crisis.
I vigorously deny that I'm responsible for the financial crisis, although if we had lost that case, it might have been a different story, because there would have been some fallout, I think. But
And I think the Supreme Court, a couple years later, realized they had made a mistake in your case because they switched positions. But let me before I give Bob, can I finish the story and then let Bob respond to the whole story? Because here's the loose end I wanted to tie up about the agencies that regulated in this area that I think the court doesn't understand very well. When the court decides a case like this, it sees ordinary legal issues about preemption, and it applies the various doctrines that exist on that subject. But what's peculiar about the agencies that regulate financial institutions, like the OCC, which was the actor here, is they are funded by the industry they regulate. And the industry they regulate, the financial institutions, have a lot of flexibility to restructure themselves so as to choose which federal regulator they want to be under, whether it's the OTS, the OCC, or other options. So in other words, unlike the typical regulatory situation, here the regulated industry has a lot of power to control, even beyond the ordinary capture story, the institutions that are regulating it, because the money that funds the institutions is tied to whether the institutions choose to put themselves under the umbrella of that regulatory authority or another. So when the court approaches a preemption issue where the OCC is, taking a step that the industry favors, I'm not at all aware of whether the court realizes that this is not the FDA or the EPA issuing a regulation about preemption. It's an agency that's in this sort of captured financial position that is putting forward a regulation that supports the preferences of the regulated actors. Now, I say the court itself, I think, realized it had made a mistake here. And the majority of the court was not a, as I say, conventional conservative liberal group. It included Justice Ginsburg, who wrote the opinion, and Justice Breyer, and I think maybe Justice Souter. But 2 years later, in a somewhat similar preemption case, after they got lots of briefs saying, you have no idea what you just did 2 years ago and what the consequences are, the court, at least those justices, flipped and came out against preemption in a context of us think was
that
similar.
Actually presents a question that's more general, though, because you know the court is made up of generalists who aren't necessarily expert in particular areas, and it's the responsibility of the lawyers in the case, the legal community, the amici who were involved in the case, to bring all those arguments to the court. Bob, do you want to respond very quickly before we move on?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's obviously true the justices are generalists in all of these areas, so, you know, they don't have complete familiarity with all these details, but the fact is they know a lot about the basic system of federal regulation of these different banks and financial institutions. I mean, I would say in the Wachovia case that I argued, you know, what ended up carrying the day there was a strain that goes way back in the constitutional cases, all the way to McCulloch v. Maryland, that the national banks, the banks that are chartered by Congress, by the federal government, you know, are largely shielded from state hostility. You know, this was a big political issue way back when with Andrew Jackson and. You know, and you can trace that. This goes way back before the Roberts Court. Now, I will say, there is a competing strain that you will find going through the Supreme Court cases, that there is not field preemption for national banks. There are a lot of state laws that do apply to national banks. And so there are these two competing strains that are woven through the banking cases over many years. And I think I give the justices credit for having a lot of knowledge about this. Some of them are more strongly committed to this principle of federal primacy. You're absolutely right, Rick, that Justice Ginsburg was our strongest defender in the Wachovia case. Chief Justice Roberts, I have never seen him as negative in any case I've been involved in. I mean, I thought he was ready to come down off the bench, you know, and argue to the rest of the justices against my side. He was, which is not typical of him. He's usually very even-handed and restrained. So absolutely not an ideological divide. But, you know, the more recent case, Cuomo v. Clearinghouse, absolutely, I agree. You know, we're going through the Great Recession, and that, you know, the justices go through these things along with everybody else. That could be having an effect. But I would also say that was a case about discrimination. And Justice Ginsburg, who had been our biggest friend in Wachovia, very clearly stated, you know, discrimination is different. State laws against discrimination apply to national banks just like they apply to everybody else.
So I want to interject here to carry us on to the next area. So we have a group that we've sort of put together, First Amendment, Second Amendment, campaign finance, election law cases, and I'd like Paul to start us off.
Well, there we go. In talking about the courts, kind of, you know, now we move from the business cases, which especially in my new role as a private sector lawyer, I find increasingly important and interesting. But I think we're now going to talk for a little while about some of the cases that, you know, I think maybe more traditionally grab the attention of people as being what the Supreme Court is all about. And I think, you know, in terms of the First Amendment, I think Rick is going to talk about the Citizens United case, so I'll pass on the sort of 800-pound gorilla in the room and talk about just a couple of the other areas that the court has been involved in. You know, one area, of course, is the First Amendment free speech clauses above and beyond the context of campaign finance. And there, I would just point to one case that I think is going to be, you know, something of a case that we might look back to. Again, with this idea of looking back at the early Roberts Court, is something that maybe they're going to be focused on a little bit more than has been the case in recent years. And the case is this case kind of, in some ways, it seemed like a little bit of a sport. It was a case called Morse against Frederick, and it was affectionately known as the Bong Hits for Jesus case. And this was a case where a student in his high school Up in Alaska, the Olympic torch was going by, and they got the day off of school to go watch the parade. And he decided it would be great to unfurl a big banner that said, "Bong hits for the number four, Jesus." Now, one of the things that's intriguing about this case is I'm not sure, you know, you talk about the expertise of the court. whatever they know about financial regulation, and I'll leave you two to duke this out, I don't think one of the nine had any idea what bong hits for Jesus meant. I'm not even sure the kid who put this up really knew what that meant. But the principal of the school thought she knew what it meant, so she suspended. And, you know, the court in this case, you know, kind of ultimately sort of divided, you know, on somewhat more predictable lines. But what's interesting is they kind of said, well, you know, there's qualified immunity here for the school. And there were some separate opinions, including an opinion, I think, that, you know, included Justice Alito and Justice Kennedy, where they really exhibited, I think, a lot of sympathy for the free speech rights of students. And conversely, Justice Thomas issued a separate opinion that basically said, you leave your First Amendment rights at the schoolhouse gate. Get out of here. I mean, you know, these are not hard cases. And I think this is an issue, if you look out at the lower courts, this is an issue that's percolating along. It's an issue that I think is going to strike the justices as, you know, kind of a very interesting mix of First Amendment libertarianism. I don't think it's, along with kind of where the political issues here, I don't think are going to fall on normal lines, because I think there are many people, many conservatives, who feel like it's actually conservative students who in the public school setting are the ones whose free speech rights are the most important to protect. So we've come a long way from since Tinker, I guess. So, which is one of the great sort of free speech and school cases. So that's an area where I think it's really worth kind of watching.
Paul,
it's going to be interesting.
Any thoughts on that point on the Christian Legal Society case that's going to be argued soon, which involves the same tension?
Sure. Hastings Law School.
Yeah. Yeah, and this is a case that will be argued later in the term. You know, this is a cornucopia of interesting constitutional issues, because you basically have but it does illustrate the way that sometimes, you know, free speech is almost becoming more and more associated with conservative causes. I think, you know, at least in this kind of public forum, public school setting. And so in the Hastings case, the party who is asserting their First Amendment kind of assembly, First Amendment association rights is the Christian Legal Society. And what's happened in this case is that the Hastings Law School, which is a public law school, has basically said that if you want to have access to campus, if you want to have access to the law school campus, you have to sign a pledge that's a non-discrimination pledge. And you have to say that you're not going to discriminate on the basis of religion, and you're not going to discriminate on the basis of sexual orientation. Now, that's a double problem for the Christian Legal Society, because the Christian Legal Society, I think somewhat sympathetically, probably doesn't want like a Muslim leadership. So they do discriminate on the basis of religion. They say their leadership positions are reserved for Christians.
In their membership.
In their
voting membership.
No, leadership. It's leadership.
Leadership and whatever.
Yeah, and
in other words, it's not about their message, but about how they treat the students.
Well, I mean, I don't want to get in a full debate about the case. I just want to say, you know, it's this non-discrimination policy is a problem for them in getting access to the law school and law school funding, and maybe it's different for access just to the law school versus the funding. Now, on sexual orientation, they also take the position that the only appropriate kind of vehicle, if you will, for sexual relations is traditional sort of Christian marriage. So that creates a problem for them with respect to the sexual orientation policy. So, you know, they wouldn't sign the pledge. They were kicked off of campus, and they're essentially suing for access to the campus. So it's a great admixture of religion clauses, you know, freedom of association issues, but then also the issue of, is there a difference when what's at stake is not just the government saying you absolutely can't do this, but what if the government says, look, if you want our money, you know, I mean, sign up on our policy. It's not a big deal. If you don't want our money, go ahead. You know, you can have your policies off campus. So I think that's a great, you know, case to watch in terms of how these various issues essentially in the religion clauses of the First Amendment can kind of interrelate with the free speech clause. The other thing I want to talk about, and I think if we're talking about the Roberts Court, it's really worth talking about the Second Amendment. Because if you want to say what distinguishes the Roberts Court from every court that came before it, essentially, is this is a Supreme Court with a Second Amendment jurisprudence. I mean, you just can't say that about the Rehnquist Court. You can't say that about the Warren Court. The Supreme Court in the Heller decision essentially, I think for lack of a better word, revived the Second Amendment and took a constitutional provision in the Bill of Rights that had been, you know, essentially dormant since the 1930s, and the Supreme Court had a very cryptic decision called United States against Miller. And ever since then, there's kind of this understanding in the lower courts that the Second Amendment didn't protect individual rights. The Supreme Court in the Heller case recognized that the Second Amendment protects an individual right. And this term, they're going to have a case that I'm arguing part of. So again, disclosures are appropriate, but called McDonald against the City of Chicago, where the question is whether the Second Amendment applies against state and local governments, whether it's incorporated against state and local governments. If the court decides that the Second Amendment, like the First Amendment and like the Fourth Amendment, applies to state and local governments, then I think what you were going to see over the course of the Roberts Court is a fair number of Second Amendment cases. And in a way, I think from kind of just a student of constitutional law, people have strongly held views on the issue, I understand, but as a student of constitutional law, I mean, this is really fascinating because, you know, I mean, you can sort of see in real time like this whole new jurisprudence kind of come up, and, you know, it's like in so many other areas of the law, you are, you know, I mean, the First Amendment is the best example imaginable. You are so boxed in by doctrine at this point. There's so many decisions that, you know, I mean, you know, the actual, like, words of the First Amendment sort of, you know, ceased to be relevant 40 years ago because, you know, now you got to figure out, well, is it a public forum case? Is it a limited public forum? Is it, you know, is it a time, place, and manner restriction? All of which is, you know, well and good and interesting. None of those words appear in the Constitution, of course. And so in the Second Amendment, from the bare words of the Second Amendment, the Supreme Court, and it's going to be the Roberts Court, is going to have to essentially craft doctrine and sub-doctrines about the Second Amendment in ways that I think, you know, can completely determine whether or not the Second Amendment basically means
Paul,
you can't have a handgun ban,
Paul,
or whether it has all sorts of other permutations.
I want to make the radical suggestion that the second, both Heller and McDonald are really not that important. They're symbolically important because there's deep political activism in favor of the recognition of the right. But the content of the right, even if the court takes lots of cases, isn't going to look that much different from the status quo ante. So this is I don't want to say posturing, but this is the court placing itself with a particular group and sort of showing solidarity and recognition. But at the end of the day, these cases aren't going to really change the way day-to-day life is lived in most of the country.
Well, I think what I would try to do with that observation is, you know, I mean, you may be right. You may be radically wrong. The interesting thing to me,
not the first time.
The interesting thing to me is we're going to find out, and we're going to find out based on the Roberts Court, because I think I take your premise, which is if they want to, they can basically take this jurisprudence, and they can develop a standard of review for the constitutional claim. They can develop very robust doctrines analogous to time, place, and manner restrictions, but much more forgiving of state regulation and much less protective of the underlying right than we're used to in the First Amendment. And they can basically create a jurisprudence that says, you know, you can't ban handguns entirely, but beyond that, there's a huge scope for reasonable regulation. Or they could take and make this jurisprudence look much more like the First Amendment, in which case I think, you know, particularly in urban areas, I don't think the laws of Montana will change much, but in urban areas, I think this Second Amendment jurisprudence will really kind of, you know, transform the scope for permissible firearms regulation. And like I said, you know, you can look at that from the standpoint of, you know, what you think is a good firearms regulation regime, but just as the sort of, you know, kind of, you know, as a law geek, I look at this and just say, what a fascinating insight into the Roberts Court, because here they're going to take, you know, kind of, you know, this is unlike almost any other constitutional provision. I mean, we get to be present at the creation. We get to see what the court is going to do with this doctrine, what they're going to make of it over time. And as you say, they could zig or they could zag here. They could make this largely just symbolic, or they could make this a very big deal.
Paul, why do you think they went into this area? Because of their Federalist Society background? Or?
Well, in a way, I mean, you know, I think, you know, this gets a little to the point of what Rachel said, which is, I think this is a place where, you know, in some ways, judicial philosophy kind of predetermined this a little bit, because I think for a textualist, as well as an originalist like Justice Scalia, but I think of Justice Scalia as being primarily a textualist. For a textualist, the Second Amendment, I mean, Rachel's rolling her eyes, so we gotta give her a right to respond. But for somebody with any kind of textualist orientation, the Second Amendment was, you know, just something that was a huge anomaly, because, you know, I mean, Justice Scalia loves to rail about unenumerated rights that aren't in the Constitution, and here was this right that, by all outward appearances, seemed to be right there, Second Amendment to our Constitution, that had been basically read out of the Constitution, you know, at the same time where Justice Scalia would say that a lot of other unenumerated rights had been read into the Constitution.
Rachel, so, do you have a view about that?
Just the textualism versus originalism point. So I would point to things like there's a clause that says you can't have cruel and unusual punishment, and there's a question of what it is that the 11th Amendment means, and I would say there's a preamble to the Second Amendment that would create textual arguments that actually would go against what Justice Scalia was. So it was just more that I think originalism does a lot of work for him in all those contexts, and I think it actually trumps his textualism. But I agree with you that this is, it's neat for me to see an incorporation debate even, without even having to wait for the follow-up cases to see, hey, what did these nine think about the incorporation debates that were the hot legal issue of prior courts, to know how they're gonna come out. I think I know, but it'll be still interesting to see with them wrestle that.
And I can't resist. I was one of the co-counsel to the District of Columbia in the Heller case. So, I mean, I'm sure some of you have studied this. I mean, I think if you look at the text of the Constitution, which has a bunch of clauses about the militia in it, not just the Second Amendment, and if you really dig into the original intent of the framers, there was clearly a big debate about how the militias worked and how Congress would interact with the militias, and whether Congress could effectively disarm the militias by not providing that they would have any weapons. I mean, these were issues that were big issues back in 1789 and 1791, but are not terribly big issues today. So, you know, I think this was not an umpire calling balls and strikes, but that's...
So I want to move on to,
response to this.
I knew this one would take up a lot of time.
And all I would say is, you know, again, I mean, I don't really want to, you know, sort of stake out a position, you know, here other than to say, I mean, look at, you know, one of the things that makes Heller such a fascinating opinion is that, you know, it was an opinion where sort of everybody had to be both kind of textualist and originalist, because there wasn't anything else to do. I mean, like I said, in most other areas of the law, you can talk about doctrine and whether you're being inconsistent with a whole line of cases. That wasn't available. And, you know, Justice Scalia's opinion is first and foremost a textualist opinion. I mean, you can criticize it. You can say you don't think that was the umpire. You think that was one of the players on the field. But it starts as a textualist opinion. The other thing I just want to say in response to Rachel is I'm not saying that, you know, Justice Scalia, who describes himself as an originalist, is not an originalist in constitutional interpretation. But I think if you look at the, you know, kind of the things that motivate him first and foremost, I think, you know, the textualism is a real motivating factor, and at the risk of going into Rachel's kind of wheelhouse here of expertise, I think of all the decisions that Justice Scalia has written over the last couple of years, I think the one that is most kind of characteristically Scalia-esque is the Crawford against Washington case, the first in this line of Confrontation Clause cases. And the reason I say that is because he just delights in the fact that as he reads the constitutional text, you know, this provision doesn't sort of have this originalist goal of reliability. It has a means to the end. The means is confrontation. And I don't want to hear about reliability, so the opinion goes, just look at the text. It says, what you get is a right to confrontation. And if that's uncomfortable because you have a child witness or because you have a victim who wants to testify, tough. The framers made that call. They said confrontation.
So I want to put the safety on and reholster our mics and move on to a discussion of judicial elections and the Court's Voting Rights Act jurisprudence over the past couple years, two areas in which the Court seems to have decided to make a splash. And Rick, if you'd lead us off.
We're going to keep the 800-pound gorilla further in the background.
Further in the background, that's right, citizens. Yes.
So... These two cases that I want to talk about that the court decided in the last couple of years, one is about money in judicial elections, the other is about the constitutionality of the Voting Rights Act. I thought I would talk about not just in terms of legal doctrine, but in terms of what they say or suggest more broadly about American institutions and how we might think about where we are with respect to sort of basic structures of American government. The first case, this Caperton one, deals with the question of whether due process requires judges to recuse themselves, elected judges, in certain contexts where they have benefited enormously from campaign spending on their behalf from an interested litigant. And so what this case combines in terms of sort of the structure of the problem is two peculiar American contributions to democracy, you might say, neither of which any other country in the world has thought was a good idea to imitate. One is judicial elections, which no other country in the world uses. We got judicial elections in the 1830s, basically. They're a reflection of the height of the sort of populist Jacksonian democracy era in which elections were viewed as sort of the magic solvent for all of the problems of government. The more elections, the better. The people could be trusted to get rid of corrupt office holders, keep government honest. And once we got these institutions as elective institutions, as turns out to be true in general, I think, in American democracy, once an institution is made subject to the vote, it's very, very rare that that is ever rolled back and the institution is ever changed into an appointive one. And that's sort of been the history, for the most part, with judicial elections. Justice O'Connor is now trying to lead a movement to get rid of state judicial elections, in part because of some of the things taking place with respect to the spending of money in the context of choosing judges. But most other countries, you know, look at us. Whenever I talk about judicial elections, you know, overseas, the first reaction you get is, you people must be crazy. You know, like, who would think to elect judges? The second, you know, great American contribution to democracy that forms the structure of this particular Caperton case is the idea that there's a First Amendment right to spend unlimited amounts of money to try to influence the outcome of elections. Again, a view that I think no other country, no other constitutional democracy shares. So you put those two together in Caperton and you get the following situation. The Massey Coal Company had lost a $50 million judgment at trial. It was up on appeal, clearly headed to the state Supreme Court. The state Supreme Court had been divided 3-2 on cases that were a pretty good window into how they would handle the underlying issues in the Massey case when it came up there. Lo and behold, one of the justices was up for re-election, a justice who looked likely to be hostile to Massey's claim, and the CEO of Massey Coal spent, this is in West Virginia, mind you, where $3 million goes a long way, spent $3 million trying to get an alternative judge elected. $3 million was, he didn't give this money, by the way, to the candidate. This is not a contribution. He gave money to a group that took out ads to try to get this justice elected, and he spent some of his own money on ads to try to get the justice elected. $3 million was, I think, if I remember the figures, it was something like three times more than any other actor spent in the judicial election. It was, you know, obviously it was a nuclear kind of level of spending in this particular election. Lo and behold, the candidate he was attacking was defeated. The other judge got elected. The case came to the court. The court voted 3-2, with this judge voting with the majority to throw out the verdict. And then the case went to the U.S. Supreme Court, where the argument was, this must violate due process. You know, the right to a neutral, fair, impartial judicial tribunal, you know, surely has to be compromised in a context like this. And by the way, if this sounds like a John Grisham novel, it is. There is actually a John, I forget which one, but there is a John Grisham novel based on this saga. And so the Supreme Court decides ultimately 5-4 to hold that due process is violated in this circumstance. And the lineup, again, it's one of these lineups that is less familiar in the public commentary about the court, but it's Justice Kennedy joined by Justices Souter, Ginsburg, Breyer, and Stevens, with Chief Justice Roberts writing an extremely vigorous dissent.
So, Rick, I want to ask you about that dissent, because that dissent has 40 questions, 20 questions, 40 questions.
Yeah, it's like a
this is
Seder.
Yeah. Why is this decision different from all others? And so he has 40 questions needling Justice Kennedy's majority opinion for opening up Cassandra's box, basically. What do you take of his dissent? I mean, did you find it odd? I mean, because one of the takes I have on the case is it's not that big of a deal. This is an extraordinary case.
You find a lot of things not a big deal.
That's right. That's sort of one of the
lessons I'm getting from this.
Yes, I mean, it's a case that was an outlier. West Virginia was, the judicial system there was somewhat odd in that there was no intermediate court. You had a small court. There was a lot of money. The justice involved probably should have recused under his own rules but didn't do so. But it's not as though what the court said in Kennedy's opinion is going to be applicable in a million other cases down the line.
Well, first thing I'd say in response to that is, when you describe these facts and you say, the Supreme Court held that unconstitutional, and you sort of, that seems like a no-brainer. I mean, that's hard to really swallow as an acceptable way of running a judicial system. But the minute you start asking any serious questions that inevitably follow from a decision like this, when you have elections for judges, you're going to have to get messages out. And the only way you get messages out is by spending money. And in a privately financed election system, where's the money going to come from? It's going to come from actors who have money and who have a stake in the outcome of the election. And so, no surprise, right, the repeat litigants and the lawyers and the various interests that appear regularly before elected state judiciaries are the ones who spend the money to help elect or defeat candidates.
Rick, how do you think
there are a whole series of questions.
How do you think appointed systems work? Do you think politics is involved there?
It's a very different kind of politics. Of course there's politics in who gets appointed to the U.S. Supreme Court.
No, not the U.S. Supreme Court.
Well, any
New York State Trial Court.
There are always sources of influence in any system of choosing public office holders. And the question is whether certain sources of influence are particularly threatening to the integrity of the institution, are particularly undermining of the public sense of confidence and trust in the institution. I don't think it's a surprise. Once the Supreme Court decided to take this case, it was unimaginable that they would come out endorsing what had happened here, which is what a decision on the merits upholding this would have been perceived to be. But in response to Troy, I think that there are huge structural issues that a case like this raises, because the Michigan Supreme Court regularly has labor, employment, conflict kinds of issues. Unions give a lot of money on one side of that. Employers give a lot of money on the other side. Should judges have to recuse themselves in those cases because they've received money from one side or the other? Well, you can say, well, Caperton's different. There was actually a specific case pending, and this money was then given. But now what you're doing is you're coming up with sort of fine-grained lines that may help you administer this doctrine, but that avoid the really serious challenge here is that underlies the decision in Caperton, in my view.
Can I just, I want to keep the 800-pound gorilla of Citizens United safely chained outside,
yeah.
But can I just ask one question, which is, do you think, and it'll be a leading question, I mean, don't you think that if West Virginia had decided, there's a real potential for problem here, and you could get into ugly due process cases and really difficult line drawing questions like this that would be hard to administer. So what we're going to say is, you can't give more than, let's say, $20,000 in independent expenditures in a judicial election.
As a prophylactic
as
rule.
As a prophylactic right. rule of campaign finance. Don't you think that Justice Kennedy would be the fifth vote to strike that down in a heartbeat?
To hold that unconstitutional? Absolutely. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay, but I don't want to get to the 800-pound gorilla. I want to move on to the Voting Rights Act case very quickly.
Can I just ask your point? Because I don't understand the claim. If you have an extreme case, as you said this case is, maybe it makes sense to have a very limited ruling, about 19 factors that will not be satisfied in other cases, without saying that you now have to
generate a whole jurisprudence around this rule that knocks out a way that we've dealt with judges since the 1830s. I mean, isn't there a case for minimalism here?
Well, I think that's largely what the court has tried to do. And you know, this case had a lot of local color in addition to what's in the opinion, because before the recusal of the justice who was at issue in the case occurred, there was a big brouhaha after the original decision of the West Virginia Supreme Court came down 3-2, when it turned out that while the case was under submission, the very same CEO from Massey was on vacation on the Riviera with the Chief Justice of the West Virginia Supreme Court, and they were photographed together while the case was under submission. And it took a couple of months before the Chief Justice finally decided, under pressure from some of his colleagues, that he would recuse himself. And then one of the colleagues who had urged him to recuse was himself urged to recuse on the theory that he was now clearly against Massey. And so two of them recused before this ever even happened. So the case was really quite unusual, and I think it could be sui generis.
Well, let me answer Sam's question by going back to something Rachel said earlier. Because one of the things that's fascinating about this case is the lineup of justices, as we talked about. And if you ask, well, you know, why is Justice Kennedy on this side of this case, and Chief Justice Roberts and Scalia and Thomas and Alito are in dissent? I don't for a minute think that, you know, Roberts thinks this was a good way to run a judicial system, or that there's no problem or you know, perception of a problem here. But the divide in this case is a divide you see across a lot of cases with these justices, and it's one of the fundamental things that divides Justice Kennedy from some of the other justices who are considered conservative, and it explains why these patterns are often much less predictable than the conventional political view would have you believe them to be. Justice Kennedy is much more willing, as a general matter, to make decisions on the basis of the kind of considerations that Sam and Peter were just describing, which is, you know, this is so extreme, this is so outrageous, the court has to step in and say, there's a limit to how far money can go in buying judges and buying verdicts or buying, you know, decisions on appeal. And it may be very difficult to draw the line. There may be all sorts of other contexts that we can argue about. Are they similar? Are they different? Does it matter if the case is pending or not? You know the case is going to come. But fundamentally, when I see something so outrageous and so extreme, I have to be willing to read the due process clause to say there's a line there.
So I want to interject and make us stay on time. So I want to.
And Roberts and the other justices just don't believe that.
I want to turn.
They don't believe that's an appropriate way to decide.
I want to turn to Peter, who can lead us off on the separation of powers, because otherwise we'll spend the next hour talking about judicial elections. So, Peter, if you would lead us off.
Well, sure. We can go back to. We can go back to judicial elections in short order if people want to do that. I did want to talk briefly about one of the cases that's currently under submission that I think will be the next addition to the separation of powers section of constitutional law casebooks, because the court is now again dealing with the independent agencies and the way in which the president deals with the independent agencies and with subordinate entities within independent agencies or under the supervision of independent agencies. So just to remind people for a quick moment, going back to 1926, I think it was, in the case of Humphrey's executor, the Supreme Court upheld the structure of the Federal Trade Commission as an independent agency. And ever since, it has been the rule that even though the commissioners and they've never, there's no statute that says this applies equally to the SEC, for example, or the FCC, but everyone has always assumed that the commissioners of the independent agencies, in addition to the FTC, which was at issue, cannot be removed except for cause. And there's been a lot of debate about what the for cause means, and the court has interpreted for cause to the extent it has done that at all fairly broadly. So it doesn't take a lot to get to satisfy the for cause. But the president cannot just call up and say, you're out. And so that's the... it has to be. There has to be something beyond just the at-will removal. So now, in the aftermath of the Enron debacle and the accounting crisis for public companies, Congress steps in 2002 in the Sarbanes-Oxley Act, and it creates the public company accounting board.
Peekaboo.
I think I left out a word. Oversight, public company accounting oversight board, and it puts the board under the supervision of the SEC, and it gives the commissioners of the SEC considerable power over the board. The board is supposed to regulate the accounting firms and how they account for public companies' financials. So the commissioners appoint the members of the board. The commissioners set the rules for the board. The commissioners have de novo review of any sanction order issued by the board. The commissioners have the power to tell the board to stop doing anything that the board is doing. There's really quite considerable supervision of the board. But there is a provision that talks about at-will removal. And so this is the so-called double at-will problem double for cause provision. This is so-called double for cause problem with the statute. The statute is challenged by two entities, one an accounting firm from Nevada that was actually under investigation by the board, and one something called the Free Enterprise Fund, which is in favor of truth, justice, and the American way. And they brought this challenge and said that the statute is unconstitutional for two reasons. One, they said it violates the Appointments Clause because the Appointments Clause of the Constitution permits Congress to allow inferior officers to be appointed by someone other than the president. The argument, the first argument is, well, these people are not inferior officers. The members of the board are the board. That they themselves are not inferior to anybody. And of course, the comeback is, oh yes, they are. They're inferior to the Securities Exchange Commission, and therefore they can be appointed by the commissioners. The next Appointments Clause argument is, well, the commissioners are not the head of a department. The commission is not a department, and the commissioners as a group are not the head of the department, and therefore, if it's not going to be the president, it's got to be the head of a department, and the commissioners aren't that, and so they can't do the appointing. So those are the two facets of the Appointments Clause challenge. And then there's the separation of powers challenge, which focuses primarily on this double for cause removal provision.
Peter, if I could just interject, why did the court ever take this case? Because it seems to me that it's, you
not
know.
A big deal.
Well, no, no,
it's not a
no,
big deal.
It's
not
a big deal. No, this one could be a big deal. This is where I'll actually agree with Rick on something being a big deal. But it seems like in order to do anything meaningful in this case, the court is going to have to rip up a lot of the administrative infrastructure that Congress put in place back in the early part of this decade, in part to deal with the Enron problem and so forth, and the court may be ripping up lots of other parts of the administrative infrastructure that's been put together since the New Deal. So now my hair is on fire, and should my hair be on fire?
Well, I don't know about that. I think that the even the people who oppose the statute say that there are ways that they believe could the statute could be fixed pretty easily. The president could appoint, for example, the members of the board. The board could stand separate from the SEC. It could be an independent agency. So their suggestions are that, well, this is really not that difficult, even though Congress wanted the SEC to supervise.
But now that sounds like the kind of formalism, anti-pragmatic view of this area that, you know, Rachel suggested not all the members who we normally think of as conservative actually find attractive. I mean, why would John Roberts or Samuel Alito find that kind of check-the-box formalism meaningful?
Well, I think check-the-box formalism may be more attractive to some of those justices in the area of separation of powers, where you're talking about the structure of the constitutional system.
It's all about check-the-box formalism.
It's all about check-the-box formalism. But I think the extraordinary thing about the case is I read through the briefs and the decision in the D.C. Circuit and the oral argument is how different the views are of what this statute does and exactly how it operates. You would have thought that this would be some high-minded debate about the structure of our government. In fact, what it is who speaks to whom, when, and how frequently, and in what tone of voice. It's really the proponents of the statute are defending the statute by saying the commission has virtually total control over the board, and the people challenging the statute are saying the board can create all kinds of problems for accounting firms and public companies before the commission will have any opportunity to step in and fix it.
One second, Peter, from your time. Alexander Bicklett, who was a Yale law professor, talked about the passive virtues. I mean, there is a very serious jurisdiction problem in this case, and as far as I can tell from the oral argument, it was hardly adverted to.
Well, the jurisdictional problem in the case was not mentioned at all at the oral argument, as far as I could tell, and I'm not sure that I agree with my close friend Sam about how serious a problem it is, because I think this is a facial challenge to the entire statute. All right, you want to?
Well, I'm not carrying a brief in this case, but it's a facial challenge which they cannot resolve facially, because as the argument reveals, they need to know more about how this system actually works.
That's not jurisdictional, then, is it?
No, the jurisdictional argument is you wait for a final order of the agency or a rule. Well, statute is pretty clear on it, and the agency could have addressed its authority.
Well, Peter, do you think this case portends future separation of powers concern on the part of the Roberts Court, other kinds of cases along this vein?
I think this is one of those cases that when it comes up, the court is inclined to hear it because the structure looks to them a little bit different from what they have already sustained, and there are a number of them that don't particularly care for what they've already sustained. So there was some discussion at the oral argument that the principle ought to be thus far and no further. I mean, we've gone partway to perdition with Humphrey's executor, but we shouldn't go all the way by allowing, a further wrinkle on that principle.
This case, by the way, this case, which I should disclose, I've been involved in for several years, representing, I think it's 7 former chairmen of the SEC from 2 political parties who, many of whom testified in favor of the act and this particular structure, some of whom administered the statute after it was enacted and know this agency very well. And this case was on my mind when I was saying to Bob that one of the things that concerns me about the court is that I don't think they understand these structures and institutions particularly well. I guess you're not supposed to say that, you know, too harshly in public. I don't actually mean it as a really negative criticism. It's just I don't understand them that well, and I study this stuff. And they have a lot of other stuff that, you know, on their plate. But this is an extraordinarily complicated area. The SEC, since the 1930s, has worked with a whole panoply of institutions, like the New York Stock Exchange, like what is now FINRA, with something called the MSRB, which regulates the municipal bond market. You know, a whole series of entities that are, some of them private and intersect with the SEC, some are public and work under the SEC. And Congress was sort of working within that history when it created this agency. And the big part of the fight before the Supreme Court is whether the SEC has enough power over this new board to really control it, because the SEC does not have one tool. It cannot remove these people at will. Now, all of the former SEC commissioners and the people who currently administer the statute say, this is completely ridiculous. It has no consequence to the actual operation of these institutions. We as chairman or former chairman of the SEC understand that this statute gives us life and death power over this board, and this board never does, never has, and never can do anything without our approval. We control its budget. It can take no legal action without our approval. So the whole fight, the legalistic fight about the removal power, is just utterly beside the point to anything in the real world. Yet I don't think the court, from the oral argument, had that view of this. And so, again, it's consistent with my concern that, as Troy says, all of us who, you know, advocate or file briefs before the court or who write academic stuff, you know, have to help educate the court about the way these institutions operate when the court is dealing with major issues of tremendous consequence, especially going forward for the regulation of the economy, with respect to institutions they don't see a lot, and I just don't think they really have a great feel for.
So one final point in this area. There's a proposed Consumer Financial Protection Agency that's in the works in Congress. Will this case, what the court decides in this case, affect that legislation, if that legislation were to actually get much further?
It's already affecting. It is already affecting that, because the House passed a bill to create a new independent agency to regulate mortgages and credit cards. This is the Consumer Financial Product Agency. The Republicans in the Senate are extremely opposed to creating a new agency. So it's clear that if there is a new agency created, it's going to be put inside some other agency, whether it's the Treasury, the Federal Reserve, the FTC. And exactly the questions that the Supreme Court is dealing with now in the Sarbanes-Oxley case about what the relationship between the superior agency and the inferior entity have to be constitutionally are on everyone's minds already who are working in Congress and in the White House in trying to design this institution.
Peter?
I'll just say one other thing. Keep in mind that the constitutional issue here has to do with the role of the president and the creation of a structure that enables the president to carry out the president's executive power in a way that is effective and meaningful. And it was somewhat discouraging, I thought, at the oral argument that one justice mentioned frequently here today actually asked whether the president could call up the chairman of the SEC or could call up one of the members of the board and express his views as to what they ought to be doing. He commented, the justice who asked the question, that when he was the Assistant Attorney General for the Office of Legal Counsel, he would advise against making those kinds of contacts. And the suggestion seemed to be that the president could effectuate his point of view only through this sort of direct contact with members of the board, and it kind of missed the point that Rick made a moment ago and which had been made by the people defending the statute and the Solicitor General, that there are many, many pressure points here, not the least of which was the termination of all salary for these members of the board if this commission thought that they were acting improperly. So I think, you know, as a practical matter, there are an awful lot of pressure points for the commission to exercise control over the board, but whether the court will think that that is, whether five members of the court will think that that's adequate to protect the president's role as the head of the, what we all now know as the unitary executive, is another question. We'll see.
Troy, can I just say one thing on this, which is, Peter's exactly right. At the end of the day, this is really a case about presidential power, and the structure of the arguments are that this double for-cause removal provision undermines the president's power. I think it's worth emphasizing that because, you know, the Bush administration, who has not, you know, sort of been characterized as having a particularly narrow view of executive power, nonetheless took the position that this was not an unconstitutional infringement of executive power. So, I mean, I think that's something that's worth keeping in mind. The other only other point I would make is, in some ways, I'm not sure this case on its own sort of fours is a big deal. I think the bigger deal here and the thing to watch and why this is a worthy case to discuss about the Roberts Court going forward is that if the court does strike down the double four clause provision, it may well be because there are at least five justices who do take this very formalistic view of the separation of powers. And that's important because there's been a debate that goes back at least 30 years, probably at least 40 years from the time of Chadha and the line item veto, about whether to take a formalist view of the separation of powers or a much more functionalist, you know, as long as it makes sense and doesn't, you know, have, you know, Congress, you know, adjudicating cases, I think we're okay, view of separation of powers. And this might be the case where it emerges that there is a pretty solid five-justice majority for a very formalistic view, and that could have some very important consequences.
So can I jump in with one thing? It's gonna be a transition for you.
Okay.
It's a transition for you, because I just wanna tie in three things we talked about public opinion here, because I'm envisioning a court that decides for Jeff Skilling, for Conrad Black, against an accounting board to oversee financial fraud in the accounting industry that has already decided in favor of corporations contributing to campaigns. And so I'm envisioning a term that could end with all of those decisions that independently we could do this doctrinal analysis about what they're about, but you could imagine an end of term where the public says, wow, does this court have any conception at all about the current economic crisis and the little guy out there? Because it ruled in favor in all these cases. And yes, you could take each case, and we're doing the doctrinal analysis, but I think now's a good time to bring in Citizen United,
so
because I do
you.
Think it ties in.
Yes, so the 800-pound gorilla that I wanted to leave for our final few minutes, my colleague Sam Estreicher, I think, actually has to go and teach a class, is Citizens United. And I wanted to start off our discussion by contrasting Citizens United, taking Rachel's segue, with a case the court decided last term, the Northwest Austin case, NMUDNO, I think is the acronym, in which the court, everyone seemed to think the court was poised to strike down a significant part of the Voting Rights Act. And in an 8-1 decision written by Chief Justice Roberts, the court essentially makes up an argument that had not really been briefed and argued before the court, maybe I'm going too far in saying that, in order to save a significant portion of the Voting Rights Act. And everyone talked about the statesmanship of that decision, how it was exactly the kind of decision in which the court had avoided a major confrontational constitutional question, a major confrontation with Congress. Contrast that case with Citizens United, and how could the same court have decided both of those cases?
You want me to talk both about the Voting Rights Act and the campaign finance case? I'll give it a shot. Yeah, exactly. Look, one way to start in response to your question is that when the Supreme Court was confronting the constitutionality of the Voting Rights Act, and it is not the Voting Rights Act per se, not the statute that applies nationwide and was not at issue, but a particular part of the statute that had been enacted in 1965 that singled out the South for a particular regime a federal oversight, and that was meant to be, or designed initially as a 5-year temporary measure, and then was re-extended for 5 years, re-extended for 7, then re-extended for 25, re-extended for another 25. That brought us to 2007. And in 2006, the court had to face, you know, are there still good reasons for this? Do we still need this? And they extended it for another 25 years. And then the question of whether the new extension was constitutional, whether it was constitutional to continue to single out the same parts of the country that had been singled out in 1965, more or less, for this unique regime of federal oversight. Now, all the momentum there was kind of in favor of the constitutionality of the act. I mean, the court had upheld several earlier versions of the act. Congress had passed the act recently. And obviously, it would be, you know, symbolically, if nothing else, you know, unbelievably momentous for the Supreme Court to say that the Voting Rights Act, which many people view as, you know, kind of a sacred symbol of American democracy, almost quasi-constitutional in status itself, you know, was unconstitutional. Even though 8 members of the court ultimately were very, very troubled by how cavalier Congress was in addressing these issues in 2006. And so what the court did is it basically said, as loudly as it could to Congress, you really have not justified what you've done here. We're going to kind of give it a pass for now. It was almost a plea to Congress, please don't leave us in the position of having to face this question. You know, actually look at the statute, make some sensible policy decisions about the present and where we have problems, where we don't, and then we'll deal with this issue. Now, let me contrast that with Citizens United.
Can I just say one thing in response to that?
That's specific. We're never going to, this is the big issues.
All right, go to Citizens.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it was extraordinary to see the oral argument in the Voting Rights Act case and to listen to the justices who were hostile to the 25-year extension of this provision demand legislative history, fact-finding by Congress, more examples of wrongdoing by the states covered by the statute. There were 193 that were specifically set out, and that wasn't enough legislative history, that wasn't enough hearing transcripts, and I had heard that some of these justices have said that that's really not necessary. All you need is the votes of two houses of Congress and the signature of the president. And I think that the message was very clear to Congress, but it was a message that hadn't been sent in very many cases.
Well, just I guess a teeny bit about that. I mean, I testified before the Senate Judiciary Committee on the extension of the act, and I've written about it for many years, and all of us who are experts following this statute, you know, understood that in 2006 there were lots of difficult questions to confront about what had changed since 1982 when the statute had, you know, last been amended, what remained the same. And I don't think anyone went into any academic thought that the coverage that existed in 2006, which basically reproduced the 1965 coverage, really could be defended on contemporary grounds. It should maybe be expanded to cover some areas that are not covered. It should maybe be contracted. What was shocking to me as a participant in the legislative process was how Congress simply wanted nothing whatsoever to do with a serious policy discussion about these issues.
So the court gives that a pass.
Because it was way too politically charged.
So the court gives that a pass, but doesn't give a pass
now, to... Right, so the contrast, if there is one, with Citizens United, is this issue about the First Amendment and corporate and union electioneering, taking out ads, endorsing or opposing a candidate. This had been an issue that had been fought about within the court basically from the moment Congress first created the ban. So for example, the initial ban on corporate contributions to candidates in elections, this is contributions, direct giving of money, that goes back to 1907 and that hasn't been in question. But in 1947, mostly as an attack on unions, Congress in the Taft-Hartley Act extended this ban to also prohibit corporations and unions from spending money, taking out ads, opposing or favoring candidates. Now, the only time the Supreme Court confronted that statute in its initial history, in every case the court found a way to hold that the statute didn't apply, and justice, conventionally, you know, liberal First Amendment justices, Douglas, Black, Warren, wrote opinions saying this statute is unconstitutional on First Amendment grounds. It wasn't until 1980 in this Austin case that the Supreme Court for the first time really squarely confronted the question, is it constitutional to ban union and corporate electioneering? And the court was, you know, very divided, a 6-3 opinion, vehement dissents, and unlike in the Voting Rights Act area, this area had been completely up for grabs from the moment of creation. So for example, you have a series of 5-4 cases where, you know, justices are flipping positions to uphold the statute, you know, applications or reject applications. I mean, everyone who studies this area knew that the question was about as up for grabs as any, you know, question in the Supreme Court can be. Yes, there was the Austin case, but Austin itself was inconsistent with earlier cases. And if there was any area of law that I would say was, you know, unstable, up for grabs, full of conflicting principles that were going to have to be resolved, it was this issue of corporate and union electioneering. So now I don't know if that I think there was something quite different. The other thing is, I'm very suspicious of what I think of as substantive conflict about issues masquerading as kind of procedural outrage at what the court has done. So I've been very skeptical about a lot of the criticisms of the Citizens United opinion for being, you know, not minimalist, and the court reached out and it overturned a precedent and all of that. There, I don't agree with the majority in terms of the substance, but I think that if you think there is a First Amendment issue here, there are plenty of plausible justifications for the court reaching this issue in an area where people have a right to know, can they engage in this kind of political speech or not, or are they going to go to jail if they do it? And are they going to have to get, you know, a license from the FEC in advance before they do any of it? I mean, if you think there's a First Amendment interest issue here, then I can perfectly well understand reaching the merits.
Well,
and
we ought to be arguing
about the substantive conflict underneath
this. Isn't the answer then, if you believe that, if you're Justice Kennedy or somebody else on the court who thinks this is a First Amendment case, we cannot have ambiguity and uncertainty when there are these, you know, very stark prohibitions, isn't the answer then that you do what you do in the Northwest Austin case? You use statutory interpretation to narrow or sculpt the statute rather than going straight for the constitutional jugular. Why didn't the court take that out? So even those who may disagree with the substance and are masquerading that disagreement under procedural arguments, don't they have an argument there?
Well, you know, I could imagine the court having done that. The dissenters didn't make that argument. You know, they also reached the question and decided on the merits. But I think, again, in the First Amendment area, there are distinct arguments that the court's recognized for years that if you have an underlying First Amendment right, the idea that you have to run to the administrative agency on a case-by-case basis and get approval in the context of, you know, heated election disputes where timing is everything and getting information out and getting your views out, and if you err, you know, you bypass the agency and run the ad and you violate the law, it's a felony, you know, as it is. The sort of, you know, standard chilling effects arguments seem to me very significant here.
Paul, you wanted to respond to that?
Yeah, I think the big thing to understand here and differentiates these cases is that Chief Justice Roberts already tried the minimalist play in the campaign finance area a couple of years ago, back in a prior decision, the Wisconsin Right to Life case, which I argued unsuccessfully, so take this all with a grain of salt. You know, I also argued the part of McConnell that just got overturned. I was successful there. So, I mean, you know, this is an area I've spent a lot of time arguing. But he tried the minimalist play. And what happened is he convinced Justice Alito, who also had some sort of, you know, discussion in his confirmation hearing about stare decisis, the two of them decided to try to be relatively minimalist and strike down the statute as applied. And what happened is all seven justices who weren't with them in that opinion basically told them that they were full of it, to use a technical term. I mean, the four dissenters in that opinion basically said, look, this as-applied challenge is not open after McConnell. We rejected an overbreath argument. This as-applied challenge is utterly inconsistent with that. This is a ridiculous result. Then the other three justices who made up the majority, Scalia, Kennedy, and Thomas, who were in dissent in McConnell, they basically, I mean, this is the opinion where Justice Scalia describes, you know, the Chief Justice's opinion. I'm going to get this wrong, but the paraphrase here is that this is faux judicial minimalism, you know, parading as, you know, evasion, or I forget the exact phrase, but he tried the minimalist thing. It didn't work, I mean, particularly well. And I think one of the keys here, this is sort of a process point, but, and this is actually true of the Voting Rights Act where this worked, but there's an interesting dynamic here, which is there's appellate jurisdiction over these campaign finance cases. Everything else the Supreme Court, almost everything else the Supreme Court does, it's cert jurisdiction, so they can work to keep these cases away from them.
The court has to issue a disposition in these cases.
They have to, and there are lawyers that are going to keep on bringing these cases. So, I mean, you know, I really think part of what went on here is that Chief Justice Roberts and Justice Alito looked at the abuse they took in the Wisconsin Right to Life case for being minimalist. They realized that there frankly was a better argument to say that the Citizens United case was an outlier than the Wisconsin Right to Life case, because the Citizens United case was not in the heartland of the statute. Congress was concerned about 60 and 30 second ads, not 90 minute movies. So it would have been a very justifiable move to say, this is a quirky application of the statute, it's unconstitutional. But Scalia, Thomas, and Kennedy were waiting in the wings to, you know, write another sort of faux judicial minimalism opinion, and they looked down the road, and these cases are gonna keep on coming. And I think that may have been part of why, essentially, they took the
road.
And
we're out of time. I wanna thank our wonderful panel and thank all of you.